nanoHUB-U, online instruction.
Hey everyone, welcome to lecture 317. In the last lecture, we were just talking about some details of how to model defects in waveguides and calculate their band structure. Now we're actually going to look at something that's kind of related, which is the transmission of a waveguide, which may have a defect in it. So basically, here's the key concept, which is that if you have a waveguide and you have some sort of defect in it, then if it is symmetric, then you can have what's called quality factor matching, where the rate at which light enters the cavity would equal the rate at which it exits. And so when you're right at that resonant frequency, when those two things match, you can have very high transmission, even though each component by itself would create very strong reflection, which sounds very paradoxical. But we're actually going to demonstrate in the simulation directly that Maxwell's equations require that this sort of thing can happen, especially for symmetric structure. And then we'll see other examples like later in the course where quality factor matching can play a role. So what you can see here is that we have waveguide transmission that's being computed over a very broad range of frequencies. So this reminds us of some of our earlier work in calculating transmission through Kerr media, for example. Then we set up a source here, okay, which is very simple, just a Gaussian source, which has a certain frequency similar to the range of frequencies that we might have used in the last lecture. We're looking at the band structure. So maybe central frequency 0.25, DF of 0.2 or something. And then we create some symmetries in the structure. Again, we're going to impose an odd mirror point symmetry. And then we're going to calculate the transmitted flux through this flux region, which is only basically in the x direction. And then we're actually going to run this system over a fairly broad range of fields, and then basically wait until it's almost fully decayed, basically only has a final amplitude that's 0.1% of our original value. And then we're going to output both the epsilon, like basically representing the waveguide structure, as well as this HC slice. And so what is this HC slice? So this is basically capturing kind of the HC profile at a given time. And then we'll kind of capture this or add it at multiple times. So whenever the source is running, actually we're adding to this HC slice. And then at the end, we actually also output the flux spectrum. So that means we have a few data sets at the same time. And we can actually combine the first two data sets to clearly indicate what is happening to the input source over time. Like what is the physics and what's the behavior of the system? And so this is basically showing you what you get. So if you read this graph, at first it may look confusing, but probably the best way to think about it is we have this waveguide, okay? And it has this source at the end, like before we enter these three holes, okay? And so at first it propagates in both directions in the waveguide, it basically doesn't see anything else. And so as it propagates in time, of course, x is increasing in the right direction, x is decreasing in the left direction. If it's going in the left too far, then of course it gets absorbed by perfectly matched layers. But if you go to the right, then eventually it encounters the holes. And so at most of these frequencies near the central frequency, it gets reflected partially. And so you can actually see that it gets reflected, but then some of it still kind of tunnels through to that central point, okay? And then you can't really see much else like that's being transmitted, but maybe there's a little bit that's being transmitted to the far side. A lot of it's just kind of staying in that cavity, whereas the rest of it is kind of being reflected back. So it's not necessarily obvious that you would actually have that much transmission at all. But what you observe is that because this is actually a very long-lived mode, so this stays excited even after everything has started bouncing back. That actually tells us that we're going to have very narrow resonance. And also, because this structure itself is symmetric, like I mentioned before, because of the quality factor matching concept, we expect that in the long run, everything that came in at like exactly the right resonant frequency should also be able to be transmitted at that same resonant frequency. But the intensity will look weaker here because the quality factor is large. So the quality factor kind of gives you a ratio between like the amplitude of the central mode and then the traveling modes that are escaping. So then the result kind of looks like this. And so, of course, we can have easily expected that because you had a reflector over this broad frequency range, which we already kind of looked at before, from about 0.2 to 0.3, then you have like lots of reflection there. But you see a very interesting feature right in the middle of this reflection region around 0.24 or so. And so that mode actually is the resonant mode of the system. And so we're actually picking up on that explicitly in this simulation. And because the frequency grid has finite resolution and width and so on, we don't necessarily see the exact peak, but then we can actually zoom in. So you can see here, the peak was around 0.77 or so. If we zoom in a little more just on this region around 0.24, then you actually see a peak closer to 0.9. Of course, you could keep refining it, but you get a transmission that approaches 1, assuming that there's no other losses in the system except for the perfectly matched layers. So that actually supports explicitly our earlier concept and conclusion that we should have very strong transmission right at that resonant frequency. And so this is a very general phenomenon that you'll see not just in this particular structure, but a broad class of structures, which could be like a Fabry-Perot cavity or other kind of waveguide systems. So in the next lecture, we'll actually kind of go to the next level with this finite difference time domain by actually trying to directly compare to experiments and see what happens.